singing, born of this nation of white bread foundation. We're taping our king beaten off his crown. My country, tears of the sweet land of irony, spoonful of sugar to wash it now.
And welcome to, what is it, episode 7, I think?
Of, Something like that, yeah.
Culture Wars Radio, 7 or 8, depending on whether you count the missing one.
Time flies when you're having this much fun, doesn't it?
It does. But anyway, welcome to our listeners to Culture Wars Radio. This week, since our last show, there have been some interesting developments, all of them on the Putin front, basically.
Can we just agree at the outset that this was, I think, undoubtedly Donald Trump's worst week in office since he was inaugurated? It seems to me that's a fairly
probably
clear statement.
True, yeah, and maybe the worst week for the country since
yes,
then, too.
Right.
Not coincidentally.
I realize we're setting a fairly low bar here, but nonetheless, it has been absolutely breathtaking.
It's like, I really do get this over and over again since Trump started running for office, not even since he took office, that we've sort of stepped through the mirror into Wonderland.
Exactly. Through the looking glass.
And, you know, I frequently refer to him as Humpty Trumpty.
Yes.
Because he like Humpty Dumpty, he thinks that words mean whatever he wants them to mean at any given moment, and neither more nor less, you know. But it just, it's like it just, when you think it can't get any weirder, it gets weirder. And let's start with last Friday, the indictment by the Mueller team of 12 Russian military officials with the GRU.
Yes.
That they say are the ones who carried out the hacking into the DNC servers and state election systems. And you have kind of an interesting take on those indictments. So I'll let you go for a minute and explain what you think is going on.
Make no mistake, things are getting real serious. There are, I think, a couple of interesting ways to look at this. The first is in terms of what this means regarding the sort of methodical ramping up by Mueller and company of the investigation and the charges. And the second thing that I want to talk about is what this means for those persons known and unknown, as the indictment refers to them, which is intended to refer to American persons who are caught up in all of this. What does this round of indictments mean for them? So, to take first things first, Bob Mueller is nothing if not methodical, and he has gone about the business of building a case precisely as you would expect someone like Bob Mueller to do that. Things got started really in earnest earlier this year. There were some high profile indictments like, Paul Manafort. Is that his name? Paul or what's his name? Manafort. Yeah. There were some high profile hits that caught a lot of attention, but really the foundation work was done in February when Mueller laid the indictments of a number of private Russian individuals and some Russian companies who he alleged were actively involved in trying to influence the 2016 election cycle. And that was kind of the set of indictments that laid the foundation for everything else to come. But at that point, we still didn't have any kind of a tie-in to the Russian state, which is to say Vladimir Putin. That is what the indictments of last Friday did. The indictments of last Friday ramped things up from the level of private actors and private companies to now we're dealing with the the Russian military intelligence apparatus. And if you have any doubts whether that is directly controlled by Vladimir Putin, let's just dispel those doubts right now. The answer is unequivocally yes. So what this means is that the people who are on this side of the transactions are no longer simply suspected of having engaged in what ordinary kinds of financial crimes, the kinds of things that get you 18 months in Danbury, right? We're no longer talking about that. We are now talking about, again, as the indictment puts it, persons known and unknown, and you can bet that those persons know precisely who they are. They are now finding themselves in a situation where we know that they have cooperated with the highest levels of the Russian state and the Russian military intelligence apparatus. That's not just some friendly stuff that gets you 18 months in Danbury. That's the kind of thing that gets you a long, long time in a supermax facility somewhere out in the middle of nowhere, Colorado, and you're going away until your kids have grandkids, if you're lucky. As the kids these days like to say, shit just got real. And Mueller has now made it very clear that there are more indictments to come. And that kind of takes us then to the second part of what it is that makes last Friday significant. And that is what we might call Bob Mueller's 2018 special counsel prisoner's dilemma game. Because suddenly all of these persons known and unknown now find themselves in what I think is a fairly classic iteration of the prisoner's dilemma game. For those of you who may not be familiar with the prisoner's dilemma, it's game theory is what it is. If you have multiple people who are under suspicion of having participated in some sort of crime, the best strategy for all of them is to shut up and to not talk to the authorities. Nobody talks, everybody walks. That's the rule. But if you're going to talk, if you're going to drop a dime, then the best strategy is to be the first one to do so, because that's the person who's going to get the best deal. So nobody talks, everybody walks, or first to talk, first to walk. That's kind of the sort of layman's definition, if you will, of all of this. If you think you might have heard a stampeding sound coming from the area of Washington, D.C., I can tell you that's all of those persons known and unknown stampeding towards Bob Mueller's office door, wanting to line up and be the first or second in line, because those are the people who are going to get the deal. It doesn't do you a whole lot of good to be number three or number four or number five, because by then, who cares? So that's kind of what my take on it.
And let's be clear on a couple of things. One is that we didn't really need that direct connection to the Russian government necessarily, because in the real world, there's really no difference between the Russian government, the Russian mob, and the Russian oligarchy. Those are all the same thing. Vladimir Putin is the biggest mafia don in Russia. Virtually all of the billionaire oligarchs there are his lieutenants. The ones who don't want to become his lieutenants find themselves dead. So there's really no distinction. But second of all, just on the subject of these indictments, the timing of them was not a coincidence.
Oh, not at all. Not at all. Yeah.
This was Friday while he's...
Enjoy the trip to Finland, right, Don.
Right. Literally 48 hours or so before he flies to Finland to meet with Vladimir Putin. That was not a coincidence. That was Mueller making sure that the heat was at maximum temperature
Yep.
When he met with Putin. And so everyone is now anticipating what's going to happen. And he meets with Putin on Monday. And the press conference at the end of this was like, even after almost 2 years of Trump, mind-blowing.
Yeah.
Standing next to Vladimir Putin, he sold out our intelligence services, including his own handpicked leaders of those agencies, Dan Coats by name, the director of national intelligence, by saying that he believes Putin's denial that Russia interfered in our election in any way. And I want to give you this quote. He said, "My people came to me, Dan Coats came to me, some others. They said they think it's Russia. I have President Putin. He just said it's not Russia. I'll say this. I don't see any reason why it would be."
Would be.
Right.
Would.
Now, before we get to the wouldn't thing.
Yes.
At that very same press conference, a reporter asked Vladimir Putin, "Did you want Trump to win the election in 2016? Was that your preference?" And he immediately said, "Yes."
Yeah, the most honest person at the press conference was Vladimir Putin.
Right.
Let that sink in.
Right. And he said yes because Trump had talked about normalizing relations with Russia. Now, I don't know what normalizing means because we've never had a good relationship with Russia. That's what I mean. World War II, we formed a temporary alliance. But beyond that, we've never gotten along very well. We've always been rivals, right? I mean,
yes.
The Cold War did happen, as I recall. But then so the next day he's back at the White House and he says that he went back and listened to the tape because he couldn't, he said he feigned this total ignorance of, I tried to figure out why people were so upset about what I said.
Of course he couldn't figure it out. Yes.
It was such a mystery to him.
Right. Yeah. And of course, it takes 24 hours to realize that this kind of mystery is going on. Right. So the first thing one does is one goes and looks at the transcript.
Right. And he found out, oh, my goodness, I said would and I meant wouldn't.
Goodness me. I'm shocked.
This strikes me as one of those like when you tell somebody the word gullible is not in the dictionary. And if they go look, you've just sort of proven your point. Like, if you believe that, you're basically a piece of granite.
Yeah, you lack even two motor neurons to rub together if you buy that sort of thing.
This is so ridiculously unbelievable. But then he goes on and he says, "I accept the findings of our intelligence services, and I have great faith in them." But then in the very next sentence says, yeah, it could have been Russia or it could have been other people because, and I quote, "there are a lot of people out there." What?
I don't even know how to begin, you know, where to begin with this. Really.
But of course, that's not what our intelligence agencies say. They say it was Russia. In fact, if you look at those indictments that were handed down last Friday on the 12 GRU officials, the detail is remarkable.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it goes into this specific server, this specific person, this specific IP address, this technique that they use to go about compromising the server.
I mean, and as you said, the timing and the level of detail were intended to send a very clear message to Vladimir Putin. Listen, this bozo you're standing next to at the press conference may be in your pocket, but there are people in the United States who know, and we're on to you.
Yeah. Now, we're never going to get those 12 GRU officials in a court of law, of course. But this
Wait a minute, Ed. All we have to do is give up our former Russian ambassador, and then we can interview those 12 people, right? That seems like a fair trade to me, doesn't it?
No, we can watch them interview them.
That's right. Yes, you're right. But still seems like a good trade to me, doesn't it? That's an incredible offer that he made, isn't it?
Unbelievable. Yeah.
An incredible offer that he made.
Which, by the way, he can't force that ambassador to do anything anyway. So
no kidding. Yeah.
That's not going to happen, folks.
We have this pesky little thing called the Constitution that has something to say about that.
Right. And by the way, the Senate today passed a resolution saying don't allow that to happen by a vote of 98-0. So,
right.
This is not going to happen. This is a fantasy. Right. But
By the way, you've now seen that the walk back of the day goes to that particular issue, right? We now have three straight days with different walkbacks. Today's walkback was, the president doesn't really favor rolling over on the former ambassador. You saw that, right?
Yes, of course.
Yes.
We also have, by the way, this is my favorite. I just posted this on Facebook. Sean Spicer has a new book out.
Oh, good.
He came out in an interview today and said he doesn't think the Mueller investigation is a witch hunt. And my response was, that would be much easier to take seriously and to give you credit for saying so if it wasn't also true that if you hadn't been forced out of your job as press secretary, you would still be standing in front of the media right now saying that it was. And we all know that. You are a professional liar.
Yes.
There is no redemption for you at this point.
I'm happy for Sean Spicer that he's not truly as brain dead as he appeared to be every day in the White House press room. Nevertheless, his integrity and his credibility are a bit, shall we say, compromised.
Yeah, at the very least.
Yeah, at the very least.
So my point is, getting back to this for a second, is that that in one breath, he wants to say, I have faith in our intelligence services and I accept their findings. And in the very next breath, he contradicts them because they didn't say it might be other people. They said, we have the evidence that it was the Russians in the library with the candlestick.
Yeah, that's right.
We know exactly how they did it. We know who did it. We know when they did it. We know what techniques they used to do it. And so Trump, no matter what, he's talking out of both sides of his mouth,
But here's what Trump knows. Okay. That, I mean, frankly, you and I know it. And I think everybody who's listening to us knows it as well. The people who support Trump, the Republicans who support Trump, that 37% of the electorate, they don't care what he says. Oh, it's the sort of thing that the Russians wouldn't do. Well, that sounds okay to me. But then the next day, it's the sort of thing that the Russians would do. Well, that sounds okay to me, too. If Trump says it, it's good enough for me. It makes absolutely no difference what he says. Right. They're gonna support him regardless. In fact, the fact that he's willing to change his opinion and say directly contradictory things from one day to the next probably scores him more loyalty from those people than anything else.
Which is bizarre, but
it
true,
is
given what we know about social psychology and tribalism.
Yeah, it is.
So then, in the same, this was all going on, this sort of walk back of what he had said and this claim that he meant wouldn't when he said would. This is all taking place on Monday. I'm sorry, on Tuesday,
right?
Just before a cabinet meeting. And then he tried to blame it on Obama.
Well, that's the fallback, isn't it?
Right. He said, look, any Russian interference that happened while Obama was president, not me. Why didn't he take action to stop it?
Did he throw Hillary in there, too, or maybe Benghazi?
No, just
Obama? Okay, all right.
But the answer is absolutely obvious. He did.
Right. Yeah.
He did. And let's talk about some of the things he did, because I think these are really important.
Yes.
One is that the moment that they got, so this all started with the FBI intercepting communications from Russian officials about this. And that's what, when they realized, and plus the CIA, that's when they realized and had evidence that Russia was hacking into things and was planting fake news stories and that sort of thing. So as soon as they've got the evidence of this, they take it to President Obama. Obama then meets with Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell.
Correct.
And Speaker of the House Paul Ryan.
Yep.
And says, look, here's the evidence. He showed him the evidence. we have this evidence that Russia is interfering, and they're interfering on behalf of Donald Trump. We don't want to be seen as interfering or putting our thumb on the scale here, and that's the way it's going to look if we come out publicly about this and take these actions. But this obviously is not something that's a one-party thing. We don't want them interfering, period, no matter whose side they're on.
Correct.
So let's put out a joint statement.
Yes.
That will take away the partisan interpretation of it. It will.
This is Barack Obama to Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan. Let's put out a joint bipartisan statement.
Right. And let's make clear that we don't accept this kind of interference, and we're going to put an end to it, regardless of who it benefits. Let's take the partisanship out of this, and let's stand together as Americans. Mitch McConnell says no. He will not sign that statement.
Not only does he say no, what else does he say?
I don't know. Was there more to it than that?
He said that if Barack Obama released any such statement as that, he would accuse the president of being partisan, of partisan interference with the election.
Okay. I guess I didn't see that part. So then the FBI goes to the FBI's counterintelligence people. They go to the Trump campaign and said, look, this is what's going on. You need to be very careful about this. You need to be on the lookout for Russians trying to ingratiate themselves with your campaign. Because this is a very dangerous thing. And what was the response of the Trump team? They held meeting after meeting with one Russian after another.
Right.
All of which, by the way, every single one of which they conveniently forgot when it came time to put their disclosure forms together. Whether it was Jared Kushner, whether it was Michael Flynn, Paul Manafort, Donald Trump Jr., and the famous Trump Tower meeting, every single time they met with the Russians, not one of those times was ever mentioned on a disclosure form, a felony under federal law.
Right. I mean, it almost got to the point of being comical, didn't it? No, we never met with the Russians. Well, okay, we met with the Russians, but we didn't meet with the Russians about campaign stuff. Well, okay, we met with the Russians and we talked about a little campaign stuff, but it didn't have anything to do with Hillary. Okay, we were looking for information on Hillary from the Russians, but they didn't give us anything. Okay, they gave us some stuff on. I mean, it got to the point where, you know, lie after lie after lie, you know, when they were finally forced to disclose this stuff.
Right. Only after they were caught did they disclose it.
That's exactly right.
But of course, hey, look, honest mistake. We just forgot.
As you do. Yeah, honestly.
Total coincidence that we all forgot the meetings and only the meetings with the Russians, not with anybody else.
Right. You can see how that happens.
You have to be so gullible or so just plain self-deluded to believe this stuff.
Yep.
That at this point, this is almost a test of human credulity. Like, I half expect this to be, I said yesterday, I'm waiting for Ashton Kutcher to jump out and tell us we've all been punked.
Yeah.
Because I mean, we're reaching the point of being surreal here.
You know, aren't you? I almost, honest to God, and I know this. I mean, this obviously sounds ridiculous, but don't you almost kind of, sort of, halfway expect Donald Trump to address the nation some night and say this was all a gigantic piece of performance art? I wanted to see how far I could push all of you idiots before you would finally crack. And guess what? You never did. I mean, I almost expect it. I really do. That's the only way you can explain the absurdity of this.
Someone suggested to me yesterday that this was really, that Trump is actually Andy Kaufman.
Yeah, there you go.
And if it were intentional, it would be the greatest piece of comedic performance art in the history of the world.
Genius.
But it's not.
No, it's not. Unfortunately. Yeah, sadly, it's not. This is real life, folks.
So then yesterday, to continue sort of the timeline of this, yesterday, a reporter asked Trump at the beginning of a cabinet meeting if he thought Russia was still interfering in this year's election. And he twice said no.
Very clear. Which,
again, is the exact opposite of what our intelligence services are saying.
Correct.
So, again, wanted to have it both ways. On the one hand, hey, I believe our intelligence services. On the other hand, I reject what they're telling me. And Sarah Huckabee Sanders claimed that Trump was taking the interference seriously and beefing up our cybersecurity. But he hasn't named anyone to the position that oversees that issue at the White House. And when asked for examples of actions they were taking to protect our election systems from hacking, she couldn't name a single example.
I'm shocked.
Because clearly they haven't taken this seriously. And all of this, at least in part, is because he can't bring himself to admit that Russia had anything to do with it, because that undermines the legitimacy of his election.
That's it, exactly. That is precisely the problem.
Right. That hurts his ego, right?
Yes.
So, but it seems to me that's like the one thing he actually has right about any of this, is that it really does make his election less legitimate.
Sure it does.
Now, I mean, it's pure speculation. We have no way of knowing how many votes might have changed.
But you didn't need many.
But it's a pretty small number. You know, it's you know, a few tens of thousands of votes in three states, including this one.
That's right.
Where you and I both live, in the state of Michigan. So it doesn't take that many to change. I mean, we can't prove it. It's all speculation. There's nothing that can be done about it anyway. There's no mechanism in the Constitution for going back and having a do-over.
Right.
But Trump is correct that people will see this as delegitimizing his presidency. And it does.
It does.
And his ego can't handle that.
But the thing is, you're right, Ed. His people who know what's going on, who are willing to admit what happened, already think that it has compromised the legitimacy of Trump's presidency. There's no question about it.
Right. It clearly has. Although less than his own behavior has.
You know? Right.
But excuse me. Now I want to get into a question that up until a few days ago I was very reluctant to entertain, and I've heard a lot of people screaming about, you know, he's being blackmailed by Putin into doing his bidding, and I've been reluctant to go there. And I think part of it's because so much of that focused on, oh, they have a tape of him being peed on by prostitutes. Yeah. Now, who cares?
Right.
And I sort of had this notion, like, what could they have on him? Because so much has come out already. What would hurt him at this point, right? Especially if it's sexual stuff. If it's that stuff gets headlines, but who gives a shit?
Everybody knows he's a pig. So you know, and he would only be proud of the sex stuff, frankly.
Yeah.
He'd go on Howard Stern and brag about it some more.
As he has,
yes,
many times.
Right.
So, So I just sort of dismissed that. But literally after that press conference, I started to think on Monday, the one with Putin. I just thought, you know, there might be something to this, and it seems to me that it's all about possible financial crimes and Trump's ties to the Russian mafia, and crimes like money laundering. And so I did a little research, and I put together this sort of list of salient facts. First, as I mentioned before, there is no distinction between the Russian mafia and the Russian government. They are one and the same. Second is that Trump's fixer, Michael Cohen, was essentially born into the Russian mafia. He's not Russian himself, but his family has been very closely involved with the Russian mafia since before he was born. And he was, in fact, a co-owner of a nightclub that was used as the headquarters for the highest-ranking Russian mafia figure in New York City for many decades. He himself has been in business with members of the Russian mob in New York, and they were nailed in a taxi medallion-fixing scheme previously.
Right.
And in fact, I suspect that may be why Cohen even got on Trump's radar. That was the only reason that Cohen got hired by Trump, was because that meant connections to people who could get him money. Because in the 90s and the early 2000s, Trump was basically unfinanceable. He had declared bankruptcy multiple times. In each case, he left banks and bondholders with billions of dollars in worthless debt. So they weren't willing to loan him money anymore for pretty obvious reasons.
Yeah, right.
The only bank left that would deal with him at all was Deutsche Bank. And that wasn't enough because, you know, he's doing billion-dollar development deals here, many of them, you know, simultaneously.
Sure.
So they turned to Russian money. And we have that on the record from both of Trump's sons. In 2014, Eric Trump told a journalist, "We don't rely on American banks. We have all the funding we need out of Russia."
Thanks, Eric.
Yeah.
Idiot.
And a few years before that, Donald Trump Jr. told a group of investors in Russia that, quote, "Russians make up a pretty disproportionate cross-section of a lot of our assets." But they didn't just help finance his projects. They were also some of the biggest customers for those developments. The Russians have bought up Trump properties all over the country, in fact, all over the world. In Florida alone, in one area of Florida, a place that they frequently refer to as Little Moscow, 63 Russian oligarchs have spent more than $100 million on residences in Trump Towers and other developments. He has six Trump Towers in this one area. And in 2008, Trump sold a mansion in Florida to one Russian oligarch for $95 million that he had bought only 4 years earlier for less than half that price. And this was 2008, when property values had tanked completely.
Correct.
Because of the mortgage crisis. Now, that smells a lot like money laundering to me. How about you?
Does it to you? Really? Wow. I you're awfully cynical, Ed. You know, I have to say, here's the thing that frankly, you know, when you talk about how Eric and Don Jr. run around and say these kinds of things about the sources of their financing, it strikes me that part of being a Trump means you just simply assume that everybody does business the way you do, right? It's not about being above board or being a good business partner or having sound business practices. It's about lying, cheating, stealing, screwing the other guy before you get screwed first. And they just kind of assume that that's the way everybody does business. And so they're not at all afraid to admit that that's their business model. And it's just, I mean, it's amazing to me that they're willing to admit it.
And they seem to think that they're invincible.
Yeah, right. That's precisely
my point.
No matter
what they say, they can get out of it.
Yeah.
And when they said these things, of course, before he decided to run for president. And I think that Trump, his relationship with the press throughout his entire public life has been one in which he has used the press for his purposes. He has lied and exaggerated, and they have dutifully printed everything he said. And so he really thought the press was on his side. I think he was genuinely surprised to find out when he started running for president that he was playing in the big leagues now.
Yeah, right.
This isn't Page Six. This isn't the gossip columnist, Liz, whatever her name was, you know, in the New York Post.
Right, Liz Smith, yeah.
Yeah. This was serious journalism. These were serious reporters. And they were going to find every bit of dirt they could find on him. Whereas, of course, Liz Smith didn't care. She wanted to report on who he was shtupping.
That's right. You know? That's right.
So,
well, again, it goes to Donald Trump's inability to distinguish between different institutional roles. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Donald Trump, the showman, is going to run for president. And how's he going to do it? Well, he's going to be Donald Trump, the showman. And everybody will love it because he's such a great showman. He's the greatest showman ever. Never stopping to think that people are going to say, well, now, wait a minute, you know, there's a big difference between being a television bozo and having a trademark line like "you're fired" and pretending to be a tough guy, and the presidency of the United States. You know, he's incapable of drawing those kinds of distinctions.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. Jonathan Chait wrote a piece here a week or 10 days ago or so, claiming that Trump had in fact been a Russian intelligence asset since the mid-80s. Now, I think he overstates the case here.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that asset is the right word.
Right. Stooge.
That's like probably a better word. Yeah. Because I don't think it was something that Trump was just doing what was in his best interest at the time.
Correct.
He was just building connections with these Russian mob figures because they could give him money.
Doing business.
And I don't think that initially the Russian intelligence people who were sort of working him, never in their wildest dreams did they think he was going to be president.
Right.
They just saw a guy that was well-connected in big money, institutions in New York. Someone through whom they could launder money.
Huge sums of money.
Without him caring right. or paying attention
right.
to it. Because all he cared about was that the money was coming to him.
That's right. That's right.
I think they just saw a sort of marriage of convenience where both sides could do what they do without any sort of obvious malice, you know, or obvious intent that it's going to become something bigger. It was plenty big enough as it was.
Just doing some business. That's all we're doing.
Exactly. I think that's the way it was from the beginning. And then he starts running for president.
Right.
And then I think Putin went,
holy smokes,
I know exactly how to manipulate this.
Yeah, that's right. This was Putin's lucky day, wasn't it?
Yep. And we've already got our tentacles into him.
Yep.
And so we have got an exploitable relationship here that could be bigger than anything we ever imagined. And so they started working that angle. And so I don't think it was one of, you know, this was some long-term, Putin's his handler. They were leading toward this all along. I think it was happy circumstance for them more than anything else. And one of just sort of thousands of, I'm sure, similar relationships that they try to build up with people in similar positions. And in their wildest dreams, they never imagined it would turn into this, but it has,
and
they're going to take advantage of it.
Maybe along the way, we can help out a little bit, Comrade Trump, you know, we can help out with some electioneering behind the scenes, shall we say, right?
And, you know, and honestly, I'm still not convinced there actually was collusion in that sense.
You don't think
that not winning collusion, at least. I mean, it would not surprise me at all if there was never a mention beyond the few little fleeting things we've seen so far of he's on your side. He kind of wants to help, you know, vague things like that. And I doubt that there was actually, or at least that they're ever going to find evidence of an actual quid pro quo relationship there.
Yeah,
any demands that were made. I think this is just the way you do business.
Right.
We do favors for you. You do favors for us. And on top of that, Putin, look, he started out in the KGB as a profiler. He is a master manipulator. And I think Trump is such an easy target when it comes to this. And Putin is not the only one that's figured this out. I mean, we've seen other world leaders do this too. How do you get Trump to be on your side and do what you want? Flatter him.
That's right. That's it. That's all it takes.
Compliment him. It's that simple. He is a 5-year-old.
Yep.
Tell him he's a good boy and he'll do whatever you want.
Right.
And so there wasn't any need for a quid pro quo. If I say nice things about him, if I go along with his program, he's going to do the same for me. And so maybe there was. I mean, there may be more than that. Certainly there may be more than that. But I don't think it's necessary to explain things, you know. I think it could all really just be a sort of informal, you scratch my back, I scratch yours kind of thing.
That may be all it takes, right? You scratch my back, yeah. I'll scratch yours. Wink, wink, nod, nod. We all know what that means, don't we? Right. I mean, that could be precisely what it is that we're talking about here.
Right. And I'm sure I wish the word collusion had never come
right.
in here.
That's because irrelevant.
Collusion means nothing.
Legally irrelevant.
It's not a legal term. The legal term is conspiracy.
Correct.
And there are some standards that come with proving conspiracy that I'm not sure they'll ever be able to prove. But I don't think it's necessary. Because I think we're now off in, just like, you know, the Clinton thing and the Monica Lewinsky had almost no relationship to the Paula Jones and Whitewater, which is what was being investigated. It just came up in the course of that investigation. Now we're into this whole range of financial crimes. And that's what I think is going to nail it.
It's always the money, isn't it? Follow the money.
Everybody brings up the classic Al Capone
that's
got
right.
nailed for tax evasion.
That's right.
But it's the cover up and it's the all of the other things that they've come across as they've done. As they investigated this, because if you're going to investigate the conspiracy stuff, then you have to find out how might Trump have benefited from this.
Right.
That means digging into the financials. And once you start digging into the financials, oh boy, things start stinking to high heaven.
Oh, and Mueller's got all of it. You better believe he's got all the tax returns.
And that's really the key.
He's got all the financials, and he's got a staff of people who know how to deconstruct financial statements and how to follow the money. I mean, he's got a team of bad asses working on this.
And he has way more than we know. On average,
no question.
The leaks that have come out on stuff like this have been about 3 or 4 months behind when they actually took place, you know, when this stuff was actually discovered. So you got to figure 3 or 4 months ahead of us.
Oh,
in terms of what he has.
I think Mueller probably has 80 to 90% of everything that he needs to wrap this case up. And at this point, what he's doing is he's just rolling up the witnesses with the indictments. That's what he's doing.
Yeah. I think at this point, Mueller has a very clear idea of exactly what went on.
No question.
That it's now it's just a matter of filling in little spots here and there. Okay, what was the link between this and this?
And all this business about subpoenaing Trump and dragging him in front of a grand jury is a bunch of nonsense. Mueller does it. First of all, I don't think Mueller needs to do that. And number two, he's not going to contravene DOJ policy that way.
But DOJ policy doesn't say you can't subpoena.
No, it doesn't say you can't subpoena him. But if Trump is no longer just a person of interest or a subject, but he is a target, then DOJ policy says we don't subpoena targets of an investigation to appear before a grand jury, because all they're going to do is show up and plead the fifth. And that sort of tends to put them in a position where they have to incriminate themselves, if nothing else, by appearance. And so the general rule is that we simply don't subpoena targets of an investigation to appear before the grand jury.
I did not know that. That's new information. So, although I wish he would.
Oh, I wish he would too. If for no other reason than to force the issue and to force the Supreme Court to take the issue up. But it's not going to happen. I don't think he needs to.
Oh, interesting. Well, I've been wondering, why is he so reluctant to just... Because he holds all the cards.
I think it's a nonsense issue. I think it's a non-starter, you know.
Well, the point of doing it, and the reason why I hope he does it, is because it would add another layer to it. He would be forced to perjure himself.
Yeah, again, I don't think he needs it. I agree with you that the financial crimes are where it's at. I think that, you know, even if there is evidence of conspiracy, that it's going to be kind of thin. And I don't think that that's really where Mueller is focusing his efforts and his investigation. He's following the money. As you say, follow the money. It's not the crime that gets you. It's the cover up that gets you. And that's what Mueller's after. And that's what he's going to get him for.
And this is what attorneys refer to as a document case.
Correct.
And in a document case like this, There's really very little defense, isn't there?
There's not a whole lot you can do. The documents speak for themselves, as the saying goes. And so other than authenticating everything and getting it in, which is easy to do, you don't really need a whole lot of testimony to make your case. The documents speak for you.
Right. You can't cross-examine bank statements.
Correct.
Or tax returns.
That's it.
So there's very little that can be done at that point. We should probably talk a little bit also about this indictment that came down a couple of days ago, or the arrest. I guess there's not an actual indictment. There's a complaint, but not an indictment. What's the difference?
You know, I haven't followed it all that closely, Ed. I don't, you're talking about the woman Butina. Is that her name?
Butina.
Yeah. Butina. I haven't followed it that closely. I don't know. I see her as kind of and I probably shouldn't even talk about it because, again, I don't know that much about it. But I see her as kind of a bit player. I don't see her as.
I don't think she's a direct player in this. I think this is sort of another tentacle of the investigation.
Yeah. Though.
Looking at the NRA.
Right. Right.
Because there is some circumstantial evidence that the NRA got something in the range of $50 million.
Yeah.
From Russian oligarchs, which they turned around and used for pro-Trump commercials during the 2016 election.
Right.
So it's sort of a sideline to this, but the evidence they have on her, text messages and such, show that this was directly tied to Putin. And B, it ties up or involves one of the biggest special interest groups in the conservative movement.
Right.
One that has enormous amounts of money. And so the NRA could find itself in a world of trouble here. If they can make that case stick and they can show, and again, this is a matter of documents, if they can show that that money came in and was then used to affect the election, that's a federal crime.
The thing that was the most interesting or amusing to me about the whole thing was, once again, the timing. This story drops. Didn't it drop right as the news conference was starting on Monday, I think? Is that right?
No, I think Tuesday.
Is that when it happened? Okay, never mind.
I think so, yeah. Well, yeah, right in the middle of this week,
yeah,
this controversy.
You know.
Yeah, this is not although this, interesting enough, this was not Mueller.
Right. Well,
came out of the DOJ itself.
I think it was Mueller farming this out to whatever U.S. attorney ended up doing the legwork on this. I think Mueller started it, and he's only got so much staff, and they can only be spread so thin. And so he's and I wouldn't be surprised to see this kind of thing happening more often, where you farm out some of the ancillary work to U.S. attorneys in various locations, right, and have them do.
Well, we know they did that with Michael Cohen.
Correct.
That got farmed out to the
Southern District of
New York. And I haven't seen any reporting to indicate if that's what happened here, but that certainly wouldn't be a surprise. You're right. But yeah, it was the D.C. office. U.S. Attorney for the District of Columbia.
Well, and I don't think that the timing, you know, I don't think that the timing with this woman was at all fortuitous. It was deliberate. It was intended to send a message, because my understanding is, and maybe you know differently, my understanding is that they were trying to get her out of the country. They were in a big rush to get her out.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure there was an extraction plan in place.
Oh, yeah.
And that's why they arrested her and then said, you know, no bail. And yeah, that whole thing is kind of funny to me because, you know, they revealed the fact that she was having, she had a relationship with a 56-year-old Republican operative.
Right.
And I think it was Rachel Maddow the other day who said, you know, look, middle-aged men, if a gorgeous 20-something Russian finds you incredibly attractive, show a little skepticism.
You might want to be suspicious. Yeah. You know, you might want to be suspicious. I have to confess, if an attractive 29-year-old Russian woman tried to cozy herself up to me, my first thought would be, look, I don't have any money. There's nothing I got for you, you know. But I would be suspicious that there was something funny going on here. I have to confess.
Yeah. Now that I'm in a position to help you with anything.
Right. But, exactly. You're barking up the wrong tree here.
Which is why, you know, bark up if you want. I'm not going to be bothered by it because I got nothing to worry about. There's a red flag that's going to fly when that happens. You know, have some sense of who
some
you are.
Some sensibility.
And where you are in life. And what kind of people are likely to be attracted to you. You know, there's somebody out there for everybody, but your somebody might well be a Russian intelligence asset.
That's right.
So that part makes me laugh.
That's kind of funny.
But I really think the NRA could find itself in serious trouble.
It's going to be interesting.
And that's another really interesting little sideline that I think we're following. And on that note, I want to finish this up just on this because this really cracks me up. So Ted Nugent had a concert
yesterday. Oh, he did. He still plays music, does he?
He still plays music.
That's sad.
I actually still like some of his old music that I, you know, but I find him so horrible. So Roanoke, Virginia, he has a concert. And like within an hour before the concert opened, they announced that you couldn't bring your guns in.
Oh, really?
And this decision came directly from Nugent's management.
Because
that would be unsafe for him.
Why? Ted is Mr. NRA, isn't he? I
know,
always thought,
gun-free zones are the most dangerous places
to
be.
Yeah.
We got all these good guys with the guns.
So
I should be safer here than anywhere else in the world.
So, I mean, was there any explanation for this, or was it just the edict came down from Ted and that was that?
That was it.
Wow.
So, yeah, I just find that very amusing. Hmm. That it's the same thing with, you know, the NRA convention every year.
Right. Not allowed to bring your guns to the NRA convention. That's the one that cracks me up, frankly.
And the same thing with Congress. I mean, look, it seems to me that if you know, those right-wingers who support the NRA and think gun-free zones are so horrible and all you need is more guns and good guys to hold them.
Yeah, right.
Let's take the metal detectors out of Capitol Hill.
I mean, it seems to me that that's an argument for handing everybody an AK-47 when they are admitted to the Senate gallery, doesn't it?
Absolutely. You know. And yet they don't. And you know why? Because they know it's crap.
You think?
They know it's nonsense. They're just, you know, when it comes to their own, they ain't putting their own butt on the line.
They're bought and paid for. You know it as well as I do. Bought and paid for.
And partly at least bought and paid for with Russian money. Where, by the way, there is no Russian gun rights movement, and there are no gun rights in Russia.
Really?
Yeah. You can only own hunting rifles, and even then they're strictly regulated.
How interesting.
Yeah. So reality sometimes is beyond our ability to satirize.
Yes, it is.
Tomler famously said, when Henry Kissinger won the Nobel Peace Prize, satire
is
now
dead. Officially dead.
And on that note, we will end this episode of Culture Wars Radio. We're going to be recording some of our supplemental shows just for our Patreons here over the next few days. And we're going to focus those on explaining some constitutional concepts, some of the key sort of concepts in constitutional law in very plain English. Because those are make really good little 15, 20-minute segments that we hope will help our listeners understand some of the things that we're going to inevitably talk about down the line, because we love to talk about that kind of thing. So we'll have some of those supplemental shows out just for the people who subscribe and support the show financially here over the next couple of weeks. And beyond that, we will see you all again next week on Culture Wars.
Thanks,
Radio.
Everybody.
We're taping our king beaten off his crown. My country tears of the sweet land of irony.